All right, so we've gone from Senegal, Malaysia, and now Vermont. All right? As our embrace of technology leads us to become more connected to each other in ways we once thought impossible, we are becoming increasingly disconnected to each other in ways thought unthinkable. How we interact, how we create and live, and the legacy we leave is an overriding theme of the work of Jonathan Harris, who will always be called an artist, often in the same breath as storyteller, photographer, computer scientist, and anthropologist. Jonathan's work will take you on a journey exploring the experience of life human, emotion, desire, mythology, memory, ritual, science, and language in his unique and groundbreaking projects. Please welcome Jonathan Harris.
Okay, great, thanks. Hello, it's a pleasure to be here with all of you. I'm feeling really moved by the work we've seen so far and just seeing what our species is doing to the Earth is just really upsetting at times, and trying to remember the hope and the humanity amidst all that is it's a challenge sometimes. But I want to shift gears a little bit and just talk about this this strange life that we all have here in this world that we're transforming. And as I was sitting there listening to Ian speak, I was increasingly aware of my own heartbeat. I always get a little nervous before I speak in public. And so I was tuning into that, and then I'm often thinking about this fact that we have about 2 billion of these in our lifetime. And in fact, most organisms have about 2 billion of these in their lifetimes. Our heartbeats go at different rates depending what kind of species we are. And the ones that have really fast heartbeats tend not to live as long, and the ones that have very slow heartbeats tend to live longer. And in general, organisms tend to live between about 1 billion and 2 billion heartbeats. And I think it's very poetic that as humans, we tend to beat our hearts at about 60 beats a minute, which gives us about 2.2 billion. So we're kind of at the top of that list. If we were more like other organisms, we would die around age 30. But because of all of the advances in healthcare and nutrition and so on, we live much longer than that now. But with this heartbeat at roughly 60 beats a minute, it's interesting to me that that's the same number of seconds that we have in the things that we call minutes, the way that we measure our time and our lives. And so it's almost as though as we live our lives, we're walking around carrying these little clocks inside of us that are ticking away our time. And we can choose to tune into those or not from moment to moment, but it's this reminder of this this precious gift that we have here in this life, and how strange that is. And I think in the projects I've made over the years, I've tried to explore this question of this this mystery that we're all within right now in lots of different ways, using lots of different mediums and technologies. When I turned 30, I'm 38 now, but when I turned 30, that's about halfway through the heartbeats that you have, 946 million thereabouts. And when I turned 30, I had spent about a decade really glued to computer screens. I had been making all of these kind of data visualization projects that tried to operate as a kind of portraiture of this emerging human meta-organism that was coming into self-awareness through the internet, of which we all were playing a part. And I was interested in this emerging meta-organism, this kind of species-level thing that you could suddenly look at kind of for the first time through internet data. And I made all sorts of projects about how it feels, what it wants, what its mythology might be, what it might dream about. But today I'm not really going to talk about those things. I'm going to talk about what came after all those things. So I want to focus on three different works today that are each quite different, but they all kind of relate in ways that you'll see. The first work was a very personal project I started when I turned 30. I decided to leave my life in New York City and buy a car and move out to the mountains of Central Oregon. And that kicked off about a 4-year period of time where I was living in very remote places, a fishing village in Iceland, a cabin in Oregon, a place in New Mexico, a place in Vermont, and a little beach cove in California. And I started a daily practice during this time to just take a picture every day and post it online before going to sleep and write a little story to accompany the picture. It was a very simple practice. This was in 2009, so Instagram was not yet a thing in the world. And in a way, it was doing what I think a lot of us do now with Instagram, which is just keeping this visual diary of our life. As a way of tuning into what's happening. And I was specifically interested in coming back into life after all of this time looking at screens. I was interested in looking around at the world again and seeing what it would show me. And so I started doing this practice. This was one of the first pictures from that practice. I took this about a week into the project. When I had left New York, I'd moved back to my mom's house in Vermont, and I was going through the process of cleaning out my childhood bedroom. And among 18 garbage bags of stuff that I threw out, I found this picture that had been hanging on my wall for 11 years. It was of my college girlfriend, Quinn. It was kind of my first love. And I decided it was probably time to take it down off the wall after 11 years, given that she was married with kids at this point. And so I took it out of the frame and I peeled the picture off of the paper, and I saw that the sunlight that had been hitting it for 11 years had stained the paper behind the picture with a ghosted replica of the image. And I remember kind of dropping it on the bed and just thinking, like, some memories are harder to erase than other ones. So I kept it in a shoebox. From there, I started this journey out west, and I saw a road in the Badlands of South Dakota called Quinn Road, and I went down the road, and it had these grasshoppers that started jumping up out of the grass and onto the windshield of my car, and these two were framed against the sky, and it felt like a message from some alien reality or something. A little bit later, this was another image. The text for this said something to hold. This was my sister's Labrador named Strider reacting to snowballs thrown at him. This was a coyote carcass that I found stuffed into a toilet on a dried lake bed in southeastern Oregon. This was one of my favorite images from the project that I took in a hot springs in Iceland. I was sitting there with my friend, this German girl, Lisa, and I noticed that the way that her legs were diffracting through the water was causing it to look like they were coming out of her head. And it was just one of these moments when what life provides you with naturally is so much stranger and more poetic and beautiful than anything you could contrive of designing yourself. And at moments like this, it's as though there's some other intelligence that is present here and happening through the moment. And increasingly, I became interested in looking for that, which you might even call something like grace. And through this process of keeping these daily photos, I became interested in what it would be like to have a library of these kinds of things, a library of life experiences for human beings to contribute to that we could all play a part in. I was visiting Stockholm and very inspired by this public library in Stockholm designed by Gunnar Asplund. It was the first library in the world that had open stacks, which meant that anybody could walk in and just go directly to the books. You didn't need to talk to a librarian. And it reminded me very much of the internet in that way. Way that you can just go in and use it directly. So I became interested in this notion of creating a library for life experiences coming out of that daily photo practice. And so at the same time, I was conscious of these shifting forces that were happening in our world, mainly on the internet, in the internet space, but that were really affecting our lives more broadly than that. And the first one was compression. If you think about the history of human communication from books to poems, to letters, to telephone calls, to postcards, to emails, to text messages, to tweets. Each one is getting shorter and more compressed than the generation that came before. And it seemed like we were approaching this terminal velocity. Like, it didn't seem that we could get much shorter and more compressed than a tweet unless somebody invented a grunting app where you can just make monosyllabic grunts at each other, which is probably a good business idea, actually. So I was noticing this trend of compression, and it seemed like we were reaching some terminal end point with that. The second related was the trend of disposability, whereas in the past, people would think a lot and reflect a lot before deciding to share something. Now it was almost as though we were just spewing out stuff that was designed to be disposed of moments after we created it, because it would get swallowed up by the torrent of stuff that would come after it. So this trend of disposability. And then this trend of curation, that increasingly we were no longer creating things, but we were using our choices of what we liked of other people's stuff as a way of expressing ourselves. So we would retweet things, we would reblog things, we would link to things, we would like things, we would comment on things, but we would create things directly much less and less. And then the fourth one was this trend of self-promotion, that a lot of the social devices and software that was being created was encouraging us to turn our life into a kind of living advertisement, where each of us became a kind of brand that we were promoting through all of our social media expression, and the brand was judged by the number of followers and likes and so on. And so this transformation of human life into a branded act of self-promotion was another thing I saw. And so for each of these trends, I wanted to offer a reversal. For the trend of compressioning, I was interested in seeing a deepening. For disposability, a kind of timelessness. For curation, a return to creation. And for this trend of self-promotion, instead inducing a kind of self-reflection in people. And so I worked on this over the course of those 4 years that I described. This is the cabin in Oregon where I was living. I spent some time at the Santa Fe Art Institute, then in a village in northern Iceland called Siglufjörður, which is in this beautiful fjord. Where I was living in this little house with a grass roof, which all of the German tourists thought was a museum, so they would look in my window while I was sitting on the bed with coding in my boxer shorts, and they'd say hello, and they'd go, ooh, what is this man doing in the museum? And then I went to Vermont, my home state, and back to Iceland to live in this beautiful house that used to be a church. Where the beautiful aurora would show itself on winter evenings, and then ended up in this house in Northern California, in Shelter Cove in Pacifica. And I was living right on this beautiful ocean, and at the time, the Occupy Wall Street movement was just starting, and the Oakland camp was one of the most militant camps in the country. And I started hanging out there and photographing the people who lived there and talking to them about their stories and why they were there. And I was struck by how it was really people from all walks of life, all ages, all races, all economic backgrounds, people who saw a different and more beautiful possibility for how our culture could be structured than the one that we were currently living inside of. And I was really moved by this new possibility. And the marches got larger and larger. And there was this one particular day where there was a march to shut down the Bay Bridge. And that night, there was this kind of crazed feeling in the air. And in downtown Oakland, a group of black bloc anarchists invaded a building that was owned by the government. And they started spray painting the walls and claiming it as their space. And I just had the feeling that this wasn't going to end well. And sure enough, the police from all the neighboring districts showed up dressed like video game characters in their riot gear. And the protesters built a barricade out of trash cans and dumpsters and lit the barricade on fire and started waving a flag. And I said, this is really not going to end well. And then the cops gave us this warning that tear gas was about to be sprayed. And right as that warning was coming, I saw this couple kissing about 10 seconds before the tear gas canisters hit. And when I saw this moment, it occurred to me that this is kind of the point of it all in some way. It's that these things are swirling around us that are asking us to give up our humanity, and yet there are these little human moments that are still possible within them, and how beautiful that is. And a few seconds later, the tear gas hit, and we all started running. I ended up getting arrested that night and spending the next 18 hours in a jail cell, which I don't recommend. But a few weeks after this, I launched the project that became Cowbird, which had three goals. The first was to create a space for this this kind of deeper kind of self-reflection. The middle goal was to create the place for this these human events that are inside of these larger news stories. And then the third was to create this library of life experiences. So this launched as Cowbird, and I wanted to show you a couple stories from Cowbird to give you a feeling for it. This first one was posted by a guy named Whitney Jones who had recently left the Mormon church, and he posted this. It's an audio
story.
Here's
the story of my first love. I don't usually tell it all at once because it's a really long story. But I will try to condense the 13 years down a little bit. This is a list of firsts that happened to me over that time, in chronological order. First crush. First date. First time telling someone I like her. First unrequited like. First time persisting anyway. First kiss. First epistolary romance. First girlfriend. First love. First time buying a ring. First time asking someone to marry me. First time getting married. First time getting walked in on by a cleaning lady in the honeymoon suite while in various stages of undress. First time having sex. First apartment together. First vacation together. First time failing at Valentine's Day. First fight. First anniversary. Second time failing at Valentine's Day. First signs of trouble. First difficult conversation. First marriage counseling session. First time losing hope that things would ever get better. First time deciding to leave. First time breaking someone's heart. First separation. First divorce.
Another one I'd like to share was posted by a woman named Jillian Bostock, who is actually a college classmate of mine, and her sister Cecily killed herself in their family's home in Menlo Park, California, when we were sophomores in college. She used a kitchen knife and stabbed herself in the middle of the night, and her parents came out into the kitchen and found their daughter on the ground next to the stove. And called Jillian, and Jillian posted this story about this experience. My sister passed away 10 years ago today. I can still hear my dad's voice at the other end of the line. It's Cecily, darling. She died in the middle of a clear, cold night, the stars twinkling above her through the skylight. I was 3,000 miles away. Here she is, looking straight into me, as if my camera was never there. As if it was just the two of us, the sky, the ocean, and the sand. I often wonder what it would be like to see her again. The pain of the loss is so unbearable, I would probably fall to the floor. But really, I would want to wrap my arms around her and tell her that I missed her so. I look at this photograph when I want to see her again, because at least with this, I can see her there. I wonder how many miles apart we are right now. I love you, Cess. Cecily, darling. So this space, Cowbird, became a repository for stories that had this kind of level of feeling and depth, and it just felt like nowhere else on the internet. They weren't all so sad and difficult and melancholy. This is one that our very own beloved Aaron Huey posted about his son Hawkeye when they saw a rainbow on a family trip, and I'll play you the audio of them.
Rainbow. That's just rainbow. Rainbow.
What's the sound you make when you see a rainbow?
Rainbow sound. We hear a more.
Can you make the rainbow sound? Very good, thank you.
Rainbow!
So over the years, these kinds of beautiful stories started to stream in. And then at some point, I started to notice a shift in some of them. This is a story posted by a woman in Sweden. And I'll read you what she wrote with it. It's called Feel It. We were on a cruise ship from Finland to Sweden. We watched as the ship came closer to land, me with my camera in hand as usual. Then I saw he was sad all of a sudden. Are you upset about something, Folke? Yes. I want you to stop taking pictures and stand with me and feel the wind instead. So that's what I did. So around this time, I also became aware of this this way in which our technologies were becoming more and more addictive and more like drugs. And even the language we use around them, like users and viral and words like this, is the same rhetoric that we use around drugs. And I became aware that there was this new trend of social engineering that was happening, where you had these Silicon Valley companies that had small groups of mainly men who were white in their 20s or 30s, developing these highly addictive programs that were being used by millions of people all around the world, and that what they were doing was not really just software engineering, but was social engineering. It was tapping into brain psychologies to induce certain kinds of behavior patterns, of which we're all so familiar now. And I became aware of these two different kinds of companies, healers and dealers. Healers being companies that use technology as a way of solving a need and getting out of the way. So these would be the Airbnbs and the Kickstarters and the Etsys of the world. And then these other kind of companies that are more like dealers, that operate on the economy of human attention, which would be the Facebooks of the world. And that these dealer companies were monopolizing human attention in a very similar way to the way that robber barons monopolized other natural resources like oil and timber and water and sugar back in the late 1800s, in both cases huge fortunes being made. And I saw this trend happening, and I saw this kind of new relationship that we're all having with technology. And I wanted to make a project exploring that. So I worked with a friend, Greg Hochmuth, who was one of the early Instagram engineers, and we made this project that explored human behavior through internet data, showing the kind of the darker side of the data that we were all creating. So we worked with Mechanical Turk, which is a service of Amazon where you can assign anonymous workers around the world small amounts of money to perform tasks for you. So we had these workers gather us examples of 100 different human bodily behaviors that they found within YouTube videos. This is the behavior nodding. They also found us lots of examples of kissing and yawning and 97 other behaviors. We gathered 10,000 video clips and all in this way. And we put these together into this kind of dystopian internet framework called Network Effect, which if we could switch to my laptop, great. So I'll show you this now. So it says, the internet is said to show our common humanity. Through its data, it's said to provide a kind of omniscience, and through its social networks, a deeper sense of connection. For those without access, it holds the promise of a better life. For those of us who use it a lot, its power to affect our lives is clear. But what's the nature of that effect? How does it change our behavior, the way we see others, and the way we see ourselves? So it drops you into this strange space where these videos are playing, and if you move your mouse here, you see all these verbs. And if you click on one of these verbs, you're dropped into an environment showing people doing that thing while you're hearing the audio of tweets that talk about that thing being read aloud by Mechanical Turk workers. And it's kind of like a CNN, this is people pointing, it's kind of a CNN environment where you have all these infographics at the bottom telling you about this activity. So you see that pointing is 56% male. It looks like it's been rising from 1900 to 2008. There's some news clips about pointing here. There's an average of 34 million people pointing right now at this moment. There's some other statistics about pointing. This is adverbs showing how people point. They point reasonably, they point upward, they point dryly. And you wonder, what is going on here? What is all this stuff? And then you can click around here, you're driving, you can see people driving. And you can see driving is a 59% male activity. You can zoom in there. And you can read down here that the word usage of the word drive in Google Books corpus from 1900 to 2007, and then the pronouns of male or female that occur next to that word is actually how this graph is being computed. So there's actually somehow real data under all this insanity. You see crafting was a very female activity until recently. It's gotten more balanced. And then you can also see the number of people that are burning right now. This is a wisdom of the crowd survey where you ask enough people an impossible to answer question, and then you take the median of what they all guess, and you say that, well, that's probably a good guess of what the answer is. So they guess that 12 million people are burning at this moment. So anyway, this goes on, and I won't kind of belabor the point, except to say that it's trying to show what this data overload environment feels like and looks like, but while playing by all of the best example rules of data visualization. All the data is real, it's really well designed, it's presented in a very sober way, and yet there's a feeling of total emptiness and unsatisfaction here. And it actually never really delivers the insights that you think it might provide you with. You see all this stuff, but you're kind of left more confused than you were to begin with. Despite its kind of titillating qualities. So you can check that out at home. It's networkeffect.io. But I just want to keep moving because I'm conscious of the time. So I want to share a few final thoughts. This is an important one, driven home by that Project Network Effect, which is just how important attention really is. And in a true sense, it's the same as your life, in the sense of what you pay attention to from moment to moment, that is what life ends up being. And we are living in this time where our attention is worth a lot, and it's trying to be wrestled from us by all sorts of different sources. And so learning to be a steward of that attention is just so important right now. So what to do about that? I had this project Cowbird, which I described. It had been running for 5 years. I had these changing views of what technology was doing to us. And so last spring, I made the difficult decision to close Cowbird after 5 years. I noticed it had become a kind of addictive space for a lot of the people who were using it a lot, not that different from the places it was designed to be an alternative to. And so I decided to close it. But I didn't just want to close it and just take that energy away. I felt it was important to give the energy of that community somewhere to go. And so I invited the community to come to my home, to my family's farm in Vermont this summer for a real life gathering around the bonfire. And about 40 people ended up coming out of the community of 15,000. the paying members were the ones who were officially invited, which is about 600, and of those about 200 RSVP'd, and of those about 40 or 50 were actually able to make it. But people traveled from all over the world to come. And it was just really strange for them to meet in person for the first time after encountering one another's stories for several years online. I wanted to do a little ritual with the community, and so I took a collection of my mother's old silver frames, which were all the same size, and I took out the glass and I took out the backing, so it was just the frames, and I built little wire stands for each of these frames, and I brought them down to this beautiful grove right on the shores of Lake Champlain on our farm, and I hung the frames from different trees in the grove so that they were highlighting different parts of nature, so each frame would frame a leaf or a piece of moss or a bit of lichen or a bit of bark. And then I invited the Cowbird community to go into that grove and in silence, each person find a frame that they felt drawn to and take it and just spend some time there with the frame and then ultimately take it home with them as a gift and a way of holding the frame up to reality, up to their life, and realizing that they actually, they don't need their Cowbird stories anymore. They don't even need their cameras anymore. They can learn just to think of every act of perception as an act of framing. From moment to moment, as we turn and pay attention to something, in a way, we're creating that moment, that reality, in that moment, and helping people see that they actually, the camera was just a tool, Cowbird was just a tool, but ultimately here we are in this world that we're creating from moment to moment. And I want to just close with this strange and beautiful quote from Toni Morrison. At some point in life, the world's beauty becomes enough. You don't need to photograph, paint, or even remember it. It is enough. So, thank you.
Cool.